After that last video, I don't know how I can do any better. But the progress has gone exponential. But I don't want to damn it with faint explanation. You know, how can I explain that the situation is just tremendous? This is the conundrum that I have here. If I try to explain it, it might just, you know, like that. But no, really, it's almost too good to be true, but it is true. And just in the nick of time, we know the July 4th, July 26th is a likely to be a very intense time. We know this next year, starting June 22nd, for a year, we know this is a time of extreme intensity in the world where turmoil and chaos are likely to strike. We know that the media is already clamping down on reporting events that tremendous turmoil events that are bring enormous turmoil. They're under orders apparently to not report certain stuff. So we are in those times, and the great thing is that I've been able to reach the key. I've been able to get a hold of the key. And I know I have the key, but I don't want to. I want to see how it plays out. I'm just getting used to this realization. I'm still in a wow mode. This morning, I didn't sleep much again last night, and I kept working and working and working. And wow, the progress is just stunning. You can't hardly put it on any sort of chart. You know, it's more like a quantum leaps that are happening. Similar to the world, the way situations are collapsing is like quantum collapses are taking place from all sorts of angles. So we're not only keeping pace with what the world's, but we're outpacing it. We're ahead of it. We're beating it to the punch. But I really have to continue every day beating it to the punch, and it's you know, it's quite a responsibility. You cannot just sit back and think that, oh, everything is just going to be fine. It is not fine at all. But we do have the key. We do have the key. I know what the key is now. I know what it is. So, those who are so inclined to hear truth and to process it and to manage their success, etc., are in a very good position right now. But it's impossible to handicap it and say, you know, what is going to happen? I don't know. All we can do is make as much progress as possible every single day and just keep the pedal down. So I will try. I don't want to damn the situation with faint explanation. It's actually very profound. And I don't really know how to give it the right treatment in terms of explanation. But it's very much along the lines that we've been practicing. Agree with your adversary quickly. And what I did was I kept following along, and then suddenly it just occurred to me what to do. It just occurred to me. The answer that I've been looking for my entire life just occurred to me. It says, oh, this is it. Very simply, very simple step. It's a very simple step, but you'll understand when I explain it to you why we have a difficult time getting to that step. And how to explain it simply. Let me just see if I can focus in on this. But it has to be put in the context of what we've been practicing. Yes, I am that perfect failure. I mean, I'm a perfect failure from deviating from what I am, from what God created me as. It's impossible. I cannot deviate. I'm total perfect failure at that. I'm total, perfectly unfair. I am that perfect unfairness. I cannot change what I am at all. And so to that effort to change what I am, I must be seen as completely unfair. Absolutely, completely unfair. I cannot change what I am. So in practicing that, you know, you get this very strong recognition and acceptance that we are exactly as God created us to be. I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me to be. So with that faith and that understanding, then there's a step that can be taken. And essentially, to put in a nice sort of buzz phrase sort of way, you say, fire all the lawyers in your mind. All the mental lawyers. What are the lawyers in their mind trying to do? They're trying to make a deal with God for you. And I brought this up previously. I say the goddess comes to you and says, who's the chief of all lawyers, mental lawyers, really. And she says, look, I know you've done something real terrible to God, and God really wants to punish you, but I'm going to lobby on your behalf and take your case up and with God and try to get some leniency for you. Okay, trying to get some leniency. So all these mental lawyers are trying to get leniency for you in relation to God, trying to get God to go easy on you. Okay, so, and then I realize, hey, wait a minute. I haven't done anything at all. I haven't done, you know, what punishment, what leniency, what do you mean? This is a trick. God has no reason to punish me at all. I just had a dream, a foolish dream, but it didn't touch reality at all. And so I'm still exactly as God created me. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. God's not angry at me in the slightest bit. So what do I need all these lawyers for who are buying time for me? They're buying time. They're saying, wait. Just a minute. I'm going to file another brief with God. I'm going to... Yeah, so what are we doing? We're waiting. We're buying time. This is what we're engaged in, and we're afraid that God is we've done something terrible to God, and God is going to punish us. So what I did is I asserted, God, I demand your final judgment on me right this instant. Final, total, perfect judgment upon me. Everything I've done, everything I plan to do, whatever, complete final judgment right now. This is what I absolutely demand. And of course, the lawyer is saying, no, you don't want that. Hold on. We're representing you. Shut up. Be a good client here. We know what we're doing. And I said, no, you don't know what you're doing. You're fired. God, I insist upon your final judgment upon me right now, without me doing anything else, this instant. Okay, I'm not going to try to do anything more to purchase leniency from you, and you can judge me any which way you want. I'm not going to say a word. You just bring your final judgment upon me right now. Now, see, now. What happens is these lawyers, the client doesn't need us anymore. They say, you're making a terrible mistake, is what they say. You're making the most terrible mistake. We know our business. I mean, we can cut a deal with God. We're working really hard on it here. And we feel we're making good progress. But you have to keep waiting. Meanwhile, here I am shaking in fear, like, oh my gosh, the axe is about to fall, I said, I can't keep living this way with all this fear and stress, let the punishment fall upon me, I'll take my medicine right now, I'm tired of this waiting game. If there is any punishment, let the judgment fall. And so, this is an extraordinary thing to say, and I really mean it. I really mean it. I said, God, I don't want you to wait another instant. I'm going to accept your judgment upon me right this instant. And I'm not going to defend myself or say a word more or any defense. I've dropped my defenses. I'm finished, completely finished. I have nothing more to say. I'm on my behalf. There's no one else speaking on my behalf. I fired all my lawyers, including fire the skirt, the goddess. You know, I fired the skirt lawyer who's the one who is most insistent that she can cut a deal with you. And so I don't have any lawyers. And I'm not defending myself at all. I'm just saying I'll accept your judgment upon me, whatever it is, right now. No more delays. And so I started practicing that. And it was obvious that this is an extraordinary step, and this is the right step to take. And I became aware, I felt different than any other practice. I said, this truly, you know, hit the jackpot. You've hit the gold mine. This is what you need to get to. Bring the final judgment. Of course, God's judgment upon us is what? That we're perfect exactly as He created us to be. We're absolutely perfectly flawless. And there's, you know, zero punishment whatsoever. But, you know, we that's what we hope, right? But obviously, we would not fire all our lawyers and rest our case and actually say, look, I don't have any case. I don't care what my case is. I've abandoned my case. You just make your judgment upon me, whatever it is. I accept whatever your judgment is upon me. We wouldn't do that unless we're quite certain, you know, that God's final judgment upon us is that nothing ever happened and we are absolutely perfect. Exactly. We never strayed from what we are at all. We haven't strayed one bit. That's God's final judgment. Just say, yeah, you're exactly the same as I created you. No worries whatsoever. So, this is the big step. This is the big step. But once you get to that step, then you realize that it's the final step, really. Because you fired all your lawyers. Fired all the lawyers. Now, it's easy to fire the mental male lawyers, so to speak. But the skirts are a lot more tenacious to say, no. They say, hey, look. Yeah, the guys are terrible. They're too tough with God, you know. But we know how to sweet talk God. Don't worry, you know. We'll amuse God and laugh, and we'll, you know, buddy buddy with God, and we'll say, hey, I've got this client. He's a really great guy, you know. And you know, yeah, he's done some things wrong, but he, you know, he means well, and he's treated us well. And if he treats us well, you know, how can he be bad? You know, look, I mean, how can a client of mine be bad? Look how wonderful I am. And they insist that they can get through to God and find some sort of leniency for me. And so they say, well, you can't fire us. That's crazy. I mean, we're the best of the best. No one's better. You won't have any representation at all. They say, that's insane. You're going to get just crushed. So that is the tough part. That is why so few get to this point. They file the male lawyers, you know, they fire them, and they think, okay, that you know, I've gotten rid of the incompetent, bad lawyers, and I'm okay. No, not at all. Because, again, what are we doing? We're waiting for a verdict. We're waiting as the lawyers frantically try and cut a deal with God. We're just sitting here waiting in hell, you know, shaking in fear. Believing, well, what kind of judgment I get? How harsh is it going to be? Yeah, because the very fact that we're desperately negotiating means we must believe that there's some punishment due us, right? We must believe it. Then the problem is, if we believe there's any punishment due us at all, we have to find a reason for that. And if we find a reason for punishment, our mind will begin seeing that, wait a minute, This punishment could be total upon me, because if I've changed myself at all, I've changed everything. I mean, you go from seamlessness to fragmentation. That is a qualitative, fundamental change. It's not just a quantitative problem at all. It's a complete qualitative problem, and the punishment could be just absolutely like annihilation. You know, so as soon as you admit you say to yourself, well, I do have a problem, that's why I have to retain these lawyers, then you can't help but have terrible anxiety. And deep down, you're very worried. And then that just makes you feel even more that you got to retain these lawyers. And you have to do whatever they tell you to do. And their fees are very high, actually. This is what I found. When you retain the goddess, her fees are incredibly high. Fees. Astronomically high. In fact, she says you'll be indebted to her forever. I mean, you can never get out of debt. The fees are so high. But she says, well, at least you won't be annihilated, you see. And you think, thank you. You're like, oh my God, you've done such a great job for me. Yeah, I'm perpetually in debt. I'm your indentured servant forever. But at least you cut a deal with God and I'm not annihilated. Wow, how fortunate I am. But then you start looking deeper and you say, wait, you know, if what Jesus said is true, I have never actually given any cause to reality to punish me whatsoever. I was dreams. Arrogance doesn't change reality in the slightest bit. It's just a foolish whim. So there is no punishment for me. So why am I retaining this lawyer and getting extremely indebted to this lawyer when the lawyer actually isn't doing anything for me? And there's nothing the lawyer needs to do. I don't even need a lawyer. Okay, obviously the lawyer doesn't want you to know this. So you can say to the lawyer, well, look, you've taken all this money from me and time and effort and under completely false pretenses, so this is nothing but a scam. You're not really a lawyer at all. You're a scam artist. So I don't owe you a penny. And I don't want you to... I just, you know, what I want you to do is I'm going to fire you. I'm going to fire you. You're fired. Your employment is terminated with me. And we'll just call it even, and that's it. And so, I'm eager to have God's judgment upon me. Most people are desperate to postpone it, right? They say, well, yeah, God, I'm not quite ready. They say, that's why they think Jesus is coming back, that they're going to be judged. So they always say, well, yeah, I'm not quite yet. He's not coming back yet because they're not quite ready to be judged. Well, they're never ready to be judged because actually, if there was a judgment, it would be annihilation if we actually had sinned against God, but we haven't. If we had sinned against God, we'd already be annihilated because we would have changed the will of God, and we are an extension of the will of God. So, this is the step where we say, okay, I'm going to call the bluff of the ego. I'm going to call the ego's bluff here, and I'm ready for the last judgment right now. It's the first and the last judgment. God says nothing ever happened and your arrogance didn't do anything. Your dream didn't do anything. You're still exactly the same as I created you to be. You haven't changed reality whatsoever. And that's the final judgment. That's the only judgment I need to make and just tell you this. This is true. And so I was really arguing with this ego, the ego, called the mental lawyers of, I saying, hey, come on, you got a problem with me? Bring the judgment. I want the judgment right now. I'm not going to wait for you. I don't care what you want to file another brief. I insist on the final judgment right now. And they're saying, no, we got to file more briefs. I say, no, I insist on it right now. And this is the battle in the mind. Very interesting battle. If we say, well, I know I want it, but not yet, then that means I think there's something I need to do to try to change the outcome of the judgment, which means then I feel that judgment is justified, right? And punishment, some sort of punishment is justified, or I can make my situation better if I wait. And that's what the lawyers are saying. Just wait, and we'll get a better deal for you for sure, right? That's the situation everyone's mind is dealing with. And so this is ultimately, this is the key. And We have to practice insisting upon this. I absolutely insist, and I'll throw myself upon the mercy of God and say, go ahead and judge me right now. I'm finished. I'm finished. I'm not doing anything else in this world. I'm not going to try and be better. I'm not going to try to get on your good side. I'm not going to try and work some deal or anything like that. You just make your final judgment on me, on my soul. Make your judgment on my spirit, on my soul. The soul being a presumed effort to get better. You know, make your final judgment right now, God. I'm as ready as I'll ever be. I'm not going to even make any more efforts to do anything. And insist upon it. Keep insisting upon it. Keep insisting upon it. Yeah, so I've been doing this today, and everything's fine. I'm still fine. Haven't been annihilated. And I'm just getting used to this. Just getting used to it. And this is the kind of, you know, very intrepid step that we need to take and you see how this trumps everything that is going on in the world. I said, God, I'm not going to wait for all these judgments meted out bit by bit by bit by bit. I insist that the totality of your final judgment upon me, upon my soul, my spirit, I insist that be right this instant. I insist that it be right this instant. And keep demanding that. Now, if you are able to take that step, then you know you have the key. You know you have the answer. You will be aware of it. And you know you will have called the bluff of the ego. You called its bluff. And there'll always be a final lawyer that will be there and say, oh, yeah. Yes, you're right to fire all the other ones. They were all incompetent. That's why you failed. They failed you. Of course they're incompetent. But me? No. I'm the one that you're looking for. Now you've finally gotten rid of the rest. Now you get the best. And this is the one you got to fire. You got to fire that one. It says, no, you are fired. So you don't want to get stuck with that final lawyer who will try and pretend like you did a great job. Congratulations for firing all those lawyers. Finally, you can pay attention to me and listen to my advice instead of those others, and this is sure to succeed. You know, fire that one too. Don't even talk to the lawyer. Just insist. God, bring your final judgment upon me right this instant. So God, bring your final judgment upon me right this instant. I waive time altogether. I waive all time altogether. I choose not to have it meted out to me bit by bit by bit by bit by bit by bit throughout time. I waive my right to time completely, and I insist that your judgment fall upon me right this instant. So this is the power of this step, this key. This is the key that unlocks the door. There's no question about it. You put it in the door and it fits, and you realize, you start turning the knob and it turns, and you realize, wow, I have the key now. I have the key. So God, I insist your final judgment fall upon me this very instant. I give up any appeals. I give up the right to appeal. I give up the right to object in any way, appeal in any way. I give up the right to have your judgment meted out over long any time whatsoever. I want the totality of your judgment meted out this instant. You know, and if it's annihilation, so be it. Whatever it is, you know what I deserve. You know, better than I do. So I'll trust in your judgment on me. Absolutely, I will. And whatever it is that then your judgment, I will abide by whatever it is your judgment levies upon me. I'll absolutely abide by that. I'm giving up any objection. So keep doing this and keep purging yourself of the legalistic deluge-ness of the ego. Okay, the ego is very legalistic, and you think it represents your legal team that's trying to buy you a deal, get a deal with God for you. This heat is nice, but it's just wannabe heat, really. When you feel the real heat in the desert, then this is just wannabe heat. It's just, it's kind of tame and mild. It's not really bringing the enough intensity. So for us, we have to bring the desert heat here, like bring the full desert heat. Or maybe like a day like this helps us get ready for more intense heat. So we're breaking the ice on this final step. And once we break the ice and get used to it, then we'll be ready for the full intensity of the response from God. That, you know, so far God has not responded. And because letting me get, familiar with this step, then realize this is it. Nothing else. I'm full final judgment right now. I insist upon it. Because why? I'm not going to do anything more. I give up. I'm not going to try any more, God, whatsoever. I've had it. I'm through trying. I'm giving up. So you just give your final judgment upon me, and I will just have to accept whatever it is. That's it. Not going to try and prove my position at all anymore. I've had it. I'm worn out. I'm through with that. And I'm just tired of this legal team jerking me around so badly. And they're fired. I've let go of my legal team. That's it. That's the end to it. End of it. So just render your judgment and render it right this instant. I don't like the anxiety of waiting any longer. And so just surrender yourself to the mercy of God's judgment, and that's it. And no more thinking, no more scheming, no more planning, no more avoiding, no more buying time, no more legal consultations, all this kind of stuff. It's just, you're done with that, absolutely done with it. Now, it's interesting that severe heat can help bring this sort of mood upon you. Is you say, you know what? It's too hot. I can't do anything. It's just like, I give up. I can just sit here. I can't go out and run or play or do anything. If this is the heat, forget it. I'm finished. I give up. That can be very helpful. The heat in the world, not climate heat, the real global warming is the heating up of this world, heating up of turmoil, of agitation, of hatred, of anger. That's the heating up that's taking place. If you want to attack global warming, then go have to look at our attitudes, our spiritual situation. That's the way to go about it, actually. And it's just too hot. Governor Brown signed that inoculation, California. Forced inoculations by the state for all children now. The only way you can avoid it is homeschooling. So the state, the government, decides what to do with your children as far as pumping them full of all sorts of syringes full of stuff that parents may not want to have pumped into their children, right? But he says, well, the science is clear. Really? The science is clear? How many times have we heard that? The science is clear, and it turns out later that it wasn't clear at all. So here we go again, you know, lawsuits. I mean, it's just, what's happening in the world is just infuriating people beyond measure. And I've had enough of that. I said, look, God, if there's some, whatever your judgment is, I am tired of this wrangling. You know, we've got these stooges on the Supreme Court. You can't even, it's Politburo, not really Supreme Court anymore at all. And the decisions, one after the other, after the other, after the other, just like, this is just all political. It's all political. You know, there's no judicial intelligence among, you know, at least five of the members of the court at all. They're just stooges, political stooges. And the legal system has been subverted, and you realize, you know, what power do we have? What power does intelligence, reason, spiritual clarity, what power does it have in this world anymore? And so it has one power left to it, and that is turning to God and say, okay, God, you render your judgment upon me. I insist upon it. That's the last power we have. But guess what? The good news is that's the only power we need. It's the only power we need. So what I am advocating to everyone is do not despair, because as we feel like we're being disempowered in this world, and if we don't realize that we only need this one spiritual power, which is to turn to God and say, okay, God, I'm ready for your judgment. Bring it on this instant. If we don't realize we have this power, then indeed we are going to become very despondent. There's no question about it. But we won't become despondent because we have this power. All praise to Jesus Christ for clarifying this for me. And for the world, too. He's been working overtime, to say the least, and so have I, to get this understanding for the world right now. People are just simply, you know, becoming extraordinarily dismayed. And yet, we do have this power. Who can take that power away from us? No one. Who can take... Can we not... No matter what our legal team says, can't we not turn to God and say, God, I'm ready for your judgment, the final judgment. I'm not interested in these so-called partial judges. The legal team keeps saying, well, we're stepping God's judgment down for you, you know, and God agreed to do it bit by bit by bit. I said, wait a minute, you know, is that true? Or is that just the arrogance jerking us around? And of course, it's arrogance jerking us around. So I say, no, legal team, you're fired. You're fired. Fire your legal team. Including the chief, the skirt, who insists that the others are bad, but she's the one that can get it done. Fire the skirt for sure, okay? And accept God's judgment upon you right now. We have the spiritual power to do that, to insist upon it. Don't ask God. Insist upon it. Absolutely insist upon it. Refuse to accept anything short of final judgment right this instant. And just keep practicing that. We have the power to do that. Now, since we know that we're still perfect exactly as God created us, we know, deep down we know that judgment is, oh, God say, oh, you want me to judge you? Great. You know, yeah. He says, you're perfect. You're absolutely perfect, and you're a perfect sovereign, and here, let me pile gifts upon you to show you just my gratitude. You know, I have so much gratitude you finally asked me to render a final judgment like this and didn't keep waiting, because no matter how long you wait, the judgment's going to be exactly the same. You're perfect, so waiting is just absolutely futile. So I'm so absolutely ecstatically pleased that the prodigal son has come home and let me lavish gifts upon you, you know, just lavish. This is just, God is just, you know, absolutely elated, you know, that we have decided to waste no more time, and we've seen through this diabolical scheme of arrogance that we ourselves inaugurated by our desire to be greater than God. So deep down we realize, wow, we're not going to be condemned to punishment. We're going to be blessed, and the blessing's so great that the world just cannot take it away from us, you know, cannot. what God blessings we've given cannot be taken away from us. And since we're no longer pretending that they can, we will certainly be aware of these blessings. So, again, do not despair about what's going on in the world. Even if an asteroid hits, which is certainly possible, I wouldn't be the slightest bit surprised if that happens. Even that, you see, that's 100% the play of arrogance. God never brings anything but perfection. God only gives us perfection. And in all of this catastrophe and troubles, that all comes from the play of arrogance. We're doing it, we're dreaming all this to scare ourselves, to intimidate ourselves, actually. We're trying to prove that arrogance is true, that we really are. We really did change reality. We really did stray from how God created us to be. We really did stray from it, and here's the evidence. We're manufacturing this evidence, and some of this evidence can get very intense, like an asteroid hit, for instance, in the ocean. And yet we think, oh, you know, our spiritual power, we don't, the martial law, all this stuff, you know, how awful. Wait a minute, wait. I only need one power, a spiritual power, and that is to insist upon the final judgment for me right now. So that means I don't have to go through all this stuff at all. I don't have to go through the future, you see. I'm insisting on it right now. The totality of it, the totality. I insist, God, on the totality of your final judgment upon me for once and for all and forever, right this instant. I insist on your final judgment upon me once and for all and forever, right this instant. And keep asserting this, keep practicing this. And you see, this is the first time I'd ever gotten to this. I had not thought of this before. I really had not. This was new for me. I said, what? Like, I can do this? Why not? So it's an extraordinary breakthrough that has occurred. Extraordinary breakthrough. But the media is not reporting this, is it? No. They're not reporting disasters. They're not reporting breakthroughs. They just want to keep stringing everybody along. Because if they were reporting the bad stuff happening, the real bad stuff, people say, hey, wait a minute, you know. I want to turn to Holy Spirit and say, Holy Spirit, what can I do? And that's what I did. I actually turned to Holy Spirit. I said, Holy Spirit, it was in the evening time and last night, and I felt like I still had one more step to go, and I didn't know what it was. I said, Holy Spirit, I don't know what else to do. I think I've done everything I can do. And I've just got to be a way to save time. There has to be a way to save a lot of time. There must be some step that just trumps time somehow. I don't know what it is. I said, but whatever it is, just let me know what it is. And then I sort of forgot about it. And then I woke up at, you know, 4 or 5 in the morning, and it clarified for me, and I saw it very clearly. I said, wow, yeah. Talk about saving time. This frees me for time. I said, this is it, God. I want your final, complete, full, total judgment upon me this very instant, once and for all. That's it. No more. I'll accept it right now. So what do I need time for? I don't need any more time, do I? Talk about trumping time. Yeah, that's the real trump, isn't it? That's the real trump. The other trump is saying, well, I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do this. But this trump is, I'm trumping time entirely, entirely, entirely. And I have a better comb over than also, you know, it's actually. And then trumping time entirely. We can trump time, you see. We don't have to trump the Chinese or trump this or trump that, you know, trump these problems. We can trump time, absolutely. So we can be even more bellicose, you know, and we can go to God. Don't be bellicose to the world. Be bellicose to God and say, God, I insist that you judge me right now. Final judgment falls upon me right this instant. I have the right. I absolutely, as the Son of God, I absolutely have the right to know what the judgment of the Father is upon me. I absolutely have that right. Insist upon your right. insist upon it. And the lawyers are saying, no, 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 don't exercise that right. What are you, crazy? You're suicidal. That's nuts. No, I insist upon it. I'm exercising that right, God. I have the right to know what your judgment is upon me, because you know everything about me, past, present, future, whatever there is to know. You know everything I've done, everything I'm going to do. So I insist, exercising my right to absolutely know your judgment upon me this very instant. No more delay. And of course, this is exactly what God's been waiting for. It's very, you know, this is the ultimate, where we finally have got it. You know. So we are not in a bad spot at all. We are not. Where the universe thinks it's got us by the tail. No, it doesn't. We got the universe by the tail. It's, of course, lying and projecting as always. We have the universe by the tail. We absolutely do. We have the trump card. We have the true trump card. And we play the trump card. That's what we need to do. We need to play that card. It's time to play that card. Absolutely it is. The great thing about this era that we're in right now, these times, is that we realize, hey, I need to play this card. I want to play this card. This is the right thing to do. Whereas other times, maybe we think, well, you know, let my legal team, you know, work a little longer. But now we're saying, no, 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 this is, I've had enough. This is enough. The world's going completely insane. And I'm going to play this trump card right now. Once and for all. That's it. This is the time to do it. So it's a great time for us. It's wonderful. It's time to rejoice, actually, that the lunatics and the asylum are causing things to be so completely nutty. You know, you say, I'm not going to go for that at all. That's it. I've had it. Absolutely had it. And it takes a lot of pressure to drive us to this. It does take a lot of pressure. So, you know, love your enemies. Absolutely love your enemies. I mean, those who are making your life a living hell, you know, love them, thank them. Say, this is great. This is really focusing me into ask the Holy Spirit, what do I do? I mean, that's what I did. I said, Holy Spirit, you know, this is just, this is too much. I mean, the what's going on everywhere, from every angle, I just can't. You know, music isn't going to save me. I actually, last night, I listened to music. Actually, I remember the name of the song, Mamas and Papas, I Call Your Name. Mama Cass, you know, wonderful song with the Wrecking Crew and the vocals that they were, Mama Cass and the Mamas and Papas. And it's just like, beautiful song. And then also 1230 by Mamas and Papas and various songs, the Beach Boys, I Can Hear Music. And on and on. I just say, wow, I'm trying to get some solace, you know. I said, like, this world is just hell. I mean, not that the 60s were good. This world's always hell, actually. So that, it's not like I'm saying that these times, you know, that the old days were, oh, yeah, they were great. No, they weren't. They were terrible. They were absolutely terrible. I hated it. Absolutely hated it. But it sure was not nearly as bad as it is now, actually. Right now, it's truly hellacious. I mean, this is like, you know, everybody's going all in. How terrible can we make the situation here? And so I was trying to take refuge in music. I said, what, you know, what song can I find that will just, you know, wipe away the angst? And I said, I Call Your Name. Let me listen to that. You know, it's you know, a really beautiful song, but. Then I went to the Beach Boys and then various other, you know, stuff. I was trying to find something. But I realized, no, it's futile. It doesn't wash away the tears of looking into the future and just say, oh my God, this is hell. This is absolutely hell. So So, you know, love your enemies. Love your enemies. I mean, I'm happy Hillary Clinton is running for president. I said, there's nothing more frightening than that. And for me, it's like, you know, wow, that's like jump off a bridge time. So, you know, that just drives me to God's final judgment right now. So thank you, thank you, thank you. That is great. And the current president and the Pope, a couple of peas in a pod, you know, closet Marxists coming out of the closet now. And they say, wow, that's great. That's great. You know, the end of the church and the collapse of civilization as we know it, and the basically taking over the world by communism, which is actually what's happening. Bring it on. This is wonderful. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Because if it was still like the 60s, I might have just said, yeah, you know, this ain't so bad. I'll just tough it out for another lifetime. You know? Sure, just you know, put on some more music. I know somebody that they put themselves in this house, a labyrinthine house, and had the back of this big yard with all these fences and walls and passageways. And he took me back there, and I went going through all these. It was like going through some bazaar, you know, in Tunisia, which they haven't reported about much what happened there, have they? And finally, we got to this room, and there's this fairly large room. And on all four side walls of this room, it was nothing but shelving, housing vinyl records, and all those shelves were full, jam full of thousands and thousands and thousands of vinyl records. And then in the room he had this exquisite stereo set, the speakers, the turntable, the amplifier, okay, the tuner, everything. I mean, well, you don't need a tuner for LPs, but was like just the best of the best. And then he just had the chair in there, and he had another chair or something. And he says, hey, yeah, look what I got. Look what I got. I just met this guy in a store, you know, and he said, he managed to finagle me to come over. I don't know how that happened. And then he began talking about his life, and it was the most hideous life I've ever heard. I can't even remember what it was because it was so terrible that I cannot even explain. I can't remember. I mean, how can I could not even make up such a terrible life. And he went on and on and on and on and on, like for hours. And it almost killed me. It was so horrifying. But eventually we got to some music. I started talking, hey, about what the music. Oh yeah. So he said, this is how I survive. This is what keeps me sane, is I have all these LPs. These are pristine LPs. And he put them on, and the sound was way better than anything that you can get. There's nothing like a pristine vinyl record with the highest, best equipment playing that LP through the best speakers. I mean, you get the, first of all, you have an analog recording, a vacuum tube, vacuum tubes running everything in the recording process, running the amplifiers, running the microphones, running the recording console, the mixing board, onto magnetic tape, onto 2-inch magnetic tape, and then going onto these, you know, vinyl, and it gets this like incredibly rich, beautiful sound. Like, it's like a reverb chamber, how it makes the singing better, you know, it tends to make this richer sing. Well, it kind of, it adds, you know, to it, and it just says, wow, it's just wow. So his salvation was this room full of these LPs. And I guess I saw him in some store, he was like rummaging through, looking for, you know, some thrift store looking for LPs or something. And he finds stuff there, and he's collected all this. That was his sanity. That was his sanity. Because his life was insane. It was absolutely insane what he had been through. I didn't think he was making any of it up. I think he really had gone through that. And he was just devastated. And he said, this is the only thing that's keeping me alive. And then I thought I was going to die in there. I thought he was a lunatic. But no, finally, I just stayed very nice and calm and listening. And finally I said, yeah, I got to go. And I didn't know how to get out of there. the labyrinth was so bad, I didn't know how to get out of there, but he led me out of there. I thought he was gonna kill me or something. I was gonna die in there. It was terrible. And he said, you know what? He said, you're the best listener there is. I've never come across anyone who's able to listen to my story like that. Never. And he says, it's really quite extraordinary. And I think he was kind of blown away by the fact that somehow I didn't crumble, or I don't know, you know, if he was just a lunatic killer or what was he? I don't know. I hope not. But I guess apparently other people simply didn't want to listen anymore. You know, I let him talk and talk for hours because I was trapped. I was trapped in there. But it shook my nervous system up terrible. And so there are people that have been through hell, and you wouldn't know it by looking at them. You wouldn't know, but what, you know, family members, just the tragedies, the hideous circumstances, being ripped off, losing this and losing that, and just on and on and on, just a nightmare. He had it all in his mind like that. So he thought music's the answer, you know, and. He was trying to sell me on that. The ego was trying to sell me that music's the answer. So I got sold. I got kind of sold on that, and I didn't listen to the Holy Spirit enough. Big mistake. But last night, I listened to the Holy Spirit. I said, Holy Spirit, you know, let me ask you for the truth here. What is the way? I have to find the way. And I said, music's not the way. It just doesn't work. So I have to appeal to you to tell me. And then, few hours later, you know, the early next morning, I get this answer. You see, so all praise to the Holy Spirit. Remember to turn to the Holy Spirit in your times of distress, because certainly times of distress will come upon everyone in this world. Some quite severely, and you may think, "Wow, I'm beat. I'm just whipped. That's it. I mean, this is just too much for me." And then you take refuge in something, right? You know, whatever it might be, sex, drugs, rock and roll, you know, whatever it may be, I got to take refuge in this. You know, a lot of people are going to take refuge in all sorts of stuff. I guess there's someone today driving on the freeway here. There's reported that there's a big snarl on the freeway here because somebody just decided to go down the freeway in the wrong direction. I mean, how do you do that? I mean, there's a big center divide in the freeway. They just decided to go in the wrong direction and drive on the freeway that way. Maybe they couldn't stand the stop-and-go traffic, so they said, to heck with it. It's not so much traffic on the other side of the freeway. Let me just go over there and bypass. I don't know. But what would possess somebody to do that, you see? This is the level of insanity. Maybe this someone couldn't take it anymore. I got to take refuge. I just can't stop anymore. I'm just going to go on the other side of the freeway. Well, of course, they hit somebody, got an accident. There are people just stopping on the 70 miles an hour. Everybody's going 70, 75. And then somebody just says, you know what? You know, I don't know where I'm going. I missed it. I just got to stop. And they're just like slowing down and stopping on the freeway. I said, what are you doing? I almost hit them, you know. And slamming on the brakes. They're just saying, whoa. You know, so it's happening to people all over the world now. Is they just say, well, I gotta slow down. I gotta take refuge. What's the answer here? What is the answer? You know, are we gonna crawl in some room with all these LPs, lock the door, you know, get our junk food, whatever we're gonna get, our pretzels in there, and pretzels and popcorn and soda pop, and just lock ourselves in there and not come out, and just listen to music till the world ends. You know, this is the way people are thinking right now, actually. Everyone I talk, I said, wow, you know, just, the other saying, wow, crazy, crazy drivers. Everybody is experiencing it, not just me, everybody. So where do we take refuge? You know, we just go, you know, fill our freezer with ice cream and get some brownies and just, you know, just start eating the ice cream. And, well, of course, a lot of stoners do that every day anyway. Yeah, so it's easy for them. They just keep right on trucking with that. You know, so a lot of people will just, you know, lock themselves in a room with a hookah and a freezer, one of those top-loading freezers just open, and it's just full of ice cream. They say, I'm just not coming out. That's it. I got a massive stash here in ice cream. I'm just staying in my room forever. That's it. Music, whatever. Yeah. There's a guy today, he told me, he says, you know what? We all got to go sometime, you know. And he's talking about, it's time to go. And I go, you know, he says, when I go, I want to be in bed with two beautiful women. That's it. And then I'm ready to go. And I go, and I just said, whoa, you know, no. I said, I told him, when I go, I'm just going to turn into light. That's what, I'm just going to just expand into pure light and just disappear into pure light. That's what I told him. He's like, huh? What? He didn't quite get that one. It's okay, he's a nice guy, but you know, you're in bed with two women. That may be, you may be going to hell. You know, is where you're going. That's no way to go to heaven, I would say at all. This is body thoughts. You know, that doesn't bring you to heaven at all. So, but this is the way that people are thinking, right? This is the way that people are thinking. It's like they're thinking like, how am I going to go out? You know, the time may be coming soon. And then those I've talked about, maybe it's an asteroid's coming. They say, well, you know what? I say, you know what? I hope it hits me. I hope I'm on ground zero and hits me directly. Don't have to worry about anything else. And so everybody realizes that, you know, things are getting, there's something is up right now, right? It really is. It really is. And if you're Christian or a good doomer or whatever, you know about it. You know, we've been told about it, so we're not surprised at all. And if you're a really good Christian or spiritual aspirant, you have been working and asking the Holy Spirit for guidance and advice. And if you stick with it, you know, then we get this golden key to the kingdom. Really, the Holy Spirit gave us the key to the kingdom last night, this morning, actually, June 30th? Hallelujah, June 30th, you get the keys to the kingdom. Handed to us. Keys of the kingdom handed to us. Yeah, God, bring your final judgment upon me this instant. I'm not going to wait for some asteroid to deliver it. You deliver it yourself. Directly. Okay, not through any asteroid or anything. You bring your final judgment upon me spiritually, directly. Spiritual judgment. Right this instant, for once and forever, and once and for all, and forever, spiritual judgment upon me right now. I'm not going to try and displace it off onto the body in some physical thing on the body, like some sort of bodily punishment. You know, no, bring the spiritual judgment upon me right now. Bring the spiritual judgment upon me. This is the key to the kingdom. This is the key to the kingdom, actually. He goes, what's God going to give you? What judgment can God give you? Say, yeah, you know, here's the kingdom. That's my judgment. Boy, I created you to dwell in this perfect kingdom. You're perfect, and here's your perfect home. You know, and he say, he'll, being love, God will understand. Say, well, you know, you need to get used to it. I'm not going to, it'll dawn upon you. But sure, here's my judgment, and let it dawn upon you. Understanding the continuity issue that we have. So, we're not going to be just catapulted into the kingdom, so to speak, but the judgment will come as it will dawn upon us. It will begin to dawn upon us. And so, we are in better than good shape right now. We're in perfect shape, actually. Perfect shape. Our outlook is perfect, actually. Bad outlook? No, I have a perfect outlook. I don't have a good outlook. I have a perfect outlook. Yes, I am that perfect outlook. And that's a positive affirmation we can make. Okay, so we should be equally skilled in positive affirmations and negative affirmations, because there's purpose for both of those, okay? The negative affirmations break the power of the ego over us and its intimidation, and the positive affirmations help us accept our great good fortune. Yeah, I don't have a good outlook. I have a perfect outlook. That also helps break the ego's grip on us. I don't have a good outlook. I have a perfect outlook. I am that perfect outlook. Absolutely, I am. So, can the world give us a perfect outlook? even at its best, can it only give us a good outlook? Say, well, I think I have a good outlook. No, I have a perfect outlook. I really do. I have a perfect outlook. Now, wise business people know when they don't know, when they can't discern what the outcome is going to be, business-wise, looking for, going forward, they can't tell. It's time to sell and sit on the sidelines. It's time to sell and sit on the sidelines. This is just smart business. Smart business, okay? That's how you ultimately stay in business in the long term. There sometimes comes a point where you just can't discern, you know, which way to go, how to go. It's just, it can't read the tea leaves. And so, wow, just sell, sit on the sidelines for a while. So, you know, looking at this world, we just can't determine the tea leaves very easily. I mean, it's really hard to say. And so I've been saying for a long time, let's get on the sidelines. Let's sidestep this. Let's sit on the side. Let's sit this one out on the sidelines. Well, what better way than to sit in God's judgment upon us? Accept God's judgment upon us right now and abide in that. Abide in that. Now, if we want to get it back into it at some point, we can reject God's judgment if we really want to. We're free. We're free to dream again if we really want to. Okay, I'm saying, but of course, we won't do that. But we're free to, if we, you know, just reassuring. But it's better to sit things out right now on the sidelines. The future is extraordinarily fraught with trouble, actually. And it's so terrible, we have great difficulty waking up to it and say, wait a minute, what's going on here? Really? I mean, we the subversives are in charge. They're absolutely in charge, and their goal is to absolutely subvert this planet and plunge it into a tyrannical dictatorship of severe control. May plunge it into wars. There could be, you know, natural catastrophes coming. It is just a very strong brew. You know, it's kind of like this brew that someone's brewing, and they keep pouring all this stuff in the brew. You know, it's bubbling and steaming and hissing, and you know, the witch's brew. And you're thinking, huh? So I'm have to drink this brew, huh? Now, what are they putting in? Some pouring some other bottle and throwing some other plants in and stirring the pot, you know, and cackling all the while, you know. Yeah, you're going to love this, you know. Yeah, this is going to be great for you. Yeah, can't wait, can you? And you're saying, oh, wait a minute, you know, look what they're pouring into it. Is that what I think it is? Good Lord, I don't like that stuff they're pouring in there. And they're pouring this, and that's terrible too, and this, and it's like, wow, I don't think I'm going to like this brew. You know, I think I'm going to pass on this brew. I think it's a strange brew. I think it's too weird of a brew for me. I'm going to pass, thanks, but I'm going to pass on this one. It's kind of like that. I mean, we're looking at this brew that is being brewed, and of course, the drinking of it is the future. I mean, we're supposed to drink this stuff? Kind of seems like it's kind of, like, seems like they're kind of spiking the Kool-Aid, aren't they? They're really spiking. It's like the 60s in San Francisco, electric Kool-Aid acid test. They'd have this huge punch bowl, you know, and the Mary Pranksters, whoever the who was involved with all this, I don't, you know, the hippies, let's say, you know, the acid heads and all this kind of stuff. They, you know, they had these parties, and someone would go by and toss a little something, a little white pill in there. It's like, oh yeah, the music pulsating lights, and everyone say, oh wow, and laughing, and people, someone else come and throw something in there, maybe just to stir the punch, and you know, they were throwing acid, all sorts of hallucinogens into the punch. And then the idea was that the party, you had to drink the punch. In order to party, you had to drink the punch. And, you know, there's some people, maybe they might have said, wise people, a little bit of wisdom, in touch with their wisdom, say, ah, Yeah, it looks like a kind of a very weird party of very weird people and kind of a, trippy, but I don't really think I want to drink that punch. They said, "Well, you failed the acid test," Really? Maybe there's a bigger test and you failed that. You failed the Holy Spirit test, actually. This was a test of the Holy. I said, "No, I didn't. I succeeded in the Holy Spirit test, that's for sure. See? And you failed in that, because the test was to say no to this, right? Test is to sit it out in the sidelines. And instead, you doubled down on insanity and said, oh, and then claim that's some sort of victory. How, doubling down on insanity and claiming that's victory, what is that? That's arrogance. So it should be called the electric Kool-Aid arrogance test. Who's going to be arrogant and who's going to repent? And so they didn't repent. And they still haven't repented. I mean, you got a whole culture now that hasn't repented. So they're failing the electric Kool-Aid repentance test. Yeah, they need to repent from that. Yeah, we got the Grateful Dead doing their final concerts. Yeah, the Grateful Dead, we're so grateful. The dead are grateful to us. Which is the, was came out of the electric Kool-Aid acid culture, the Grateful Dead, of course, and basically continued that with the drugs and the dancing and the raving and all that takes place there. Not quite a rave, but it the precursor of the whole rave culture, and all of that parade culture. These are people that are failing the repentance test. They're failing it. So they're failures. They're not willing to turn to God's judgment. They're not willing. They're still buying time. They want to keep buying more time. Well, we're not in the business of buying time. We're getting out of that business of buying time. You see, we're getting out of that business of buying time. I know this man, Bill Walton, the basketball player, said, nice guy, great guy, but he's been, what, 845 dead concerts, he says, 845 concerts. keep on trucking, 845 over the years, yeah. I guess it's one for the road now, or five for the road, however many. So anyway, I can say I succeeded at the repentance test, the electric Kool-Aid repentance test. And got the keys to the kingdom, got the keys to the kingdom. That's the success that you get. Understanding that, yeah, I have the power, I have the right to accepts God's judgment upon me this instant. I don't have to wait in time. Waiting for time in time is arrogance. This is the lie of arrogance that God is going to come at some point in time to judge the world. That's arrogance. That is not true. It is not true. It is not true. That's arrogance speaking. That's buying time. That's buying time. We as the Son of God have absolute right to know God's judgment upon us this instant. This instant. We can call upon it this instant, any instant. There's no such situation as God coming at some point in time and judging everyone automatically like that. That is not true. God has already judged. As soon as we went towards arrogance, God gave the final judgment right then. And that is, God's Son is perfect, exactly as I created it to be. That's it. So it's already been given. And we have the right to accept this judgment, turn to this judgment, turn to God's final judgment, say, I want to know your judgment upon me right now. We have the right to do that. We have the spiritual right to do it. And waiting is the game of arrogance. It's thinking that you can improve the judgment. How can you improve upon perfection? See, this is the arrogance, isn't it? This is arrogance. Time is arrogance. Time is arrogance. We're thinking, well, we can improve upon God's judgment upon us. We're trying to improve upon it. Again, that's denying then, isn't it? Intrinsically denying that God's judgment upon us is that we're absolutely perfect. Perfect judgment, or perfect. Obviously, if we're trying to improve it, we're denying that this is already the case. And we must think that God has less than perfect judgment. Judging us is less than perfect. Have to. It's an inescapable logic. There is a reason, isn't it? And so that's why we keep buying time. We keep trying to say, hey, I feel that I deserve a better judgment than what I think how God's going to judge me. So I need to, you know, work on being more righteous. And I mean, Jesus' ministry was full of pointing out the righteous. That's righteousness is not where it's at. They're the ones who don't get it at all. And so there was some allegory or parable allegory about the righteous and something about people needing to repent and coming and you know, ask for forgiveness, repent and whatever. And then they said, who gets into heaven? You know, these people, the righteous. And Jesus said, well, you know, the righteous, they didn't do anything. They didn't repent at all. They thought they already, you know, were doing, already didn't need to or something. But they're really trying to, what he's saying is they're trying to improve themselves. They think that the improvement that they're what they're doing is improving God's judgment of them. And this is what is false. God's judgment upon all that God created is that it's all perfect exactly as God created it to be from the get-go. That's God's judgment. So to spend any time pursuing righteousness is actually total arrogance. Because what you're really saying is, I'm pursuing righteousness because to improve God's judgment upon me. So you're saying God's judgment upon me is that I'm not perfect, which is just arrogance's way of saying, hey, I must have changed God then. My will must have changed God. So plain and simple, isn't it? When you put it this way, it's easy to see. Not so bad today. 100 degrees is nice. It's kind of a soft 100. It's not a problem. Some clouds, you know, clouds here and there, sort of hazy clouds here and there. It's a nice summer day. So, I didn't know how this video would go. I felt I almost didn't do it. I felt like I wasn't up to it. But as usual, if you give it a try, the Holy Spirit will help out and give a boost. So keep in mind, again, repeat. When you feel despondent, ask the Holy Spirit. Say, Holy Spirit, save me some time. I don't want to keep feeling despondent. I want to know how can I get free of this despondency, legitimately get free of it, quickly, more quickly. I don't think it's going to get better, you know, the way the world is going. Who thinks the world is actually getting better? You know, I guess there's some people who actually believe that. And then, you know, where the more your identity, your life becomes electronic, the more fearful you become of hacking, of course. And we realize that there's been massive hacking taking place by presumably the Chinese, who have said that the World War III is going to be a cyber warfare, electronic warfare, and who's to say that the World War III is not already raging, actually, in that way. And the way things are going, who knows what's going to be hacked next, actually. They're hacking the federal government, everyone who has a security clearance, hacking their information. You know, can't they hack is the question. I mean, the major motion pictures, you know, have been hacked. It seems like everything's getting hacked. Major stores, you know, like Target. So is there anything that cannot get hacked? Well, yes, there's one thing. God's judgment. God's judgment and our spiritual right cannot be hacked. They can't change the code of that, you know, because the code's already, it's already been done. It's finished. We're perfect. There's no code of perfection at all. I mean, it's God's code that's uncodable, so to speak. It cannot be turned into symbols or code at all. So that's the one place to go to for a true identity that cannot be hacked. But the way it's going now is to make everyone feel super insecure, and then run to the antivirus, anti-hacker people, the IT people, and say, save us, oh my God, we're so vulnerable. Of course, they're the ones who set up the vulnerability in the first place. This is how it always works, isn't it? The ones who have, who want to sell you a solution and want to be empowered by your vulnerability to them, they set up a situation ahead of time that chases you right into their arms. Oh, we didn't realize that. They always say that. Oh my gosh, you know, we didn't realize that technology would go this way. We're really in trouble. Wow, you know, we're going to be turned into this and this and that. Oh my gosh, yeah, who would have known? You know, well, they knew very well. Of course they did. Who could have foreseen this? Well, spiritual wisdom foresaw it through and through and through. Before this even started, I was actually taken in spirit to another realm, planetary realm, and shown this civilization. And I was able to walk around and view it and experience it. And it was total technology gadget land. The people were completely obsessed by it, and their identity was completely wrapped up into it. As much as you can wrap an identity, a false identity, up into anything. And I felt like I was going to spiritually die. It was so terrible. And I was shown that. And then, now as I see this world, how it's developed, I realize, wow, this is exactly what's happening here. This is where they got it. This place has been exporting this nonsense here. And so, of course they know. Of course they know about it. And we don't want to drink that strange brew. The stuff they're pouring into it, say that's good for me, really? I'd say I'm going to pass on that. Not that desperate. Pass on the future. But again, how can we pass on the future? God's judgment upon us right now. That's how to do it. That is how to do it. There isn't any other way, actually. There isn't any other way. And all the hoops that we've been jumping through, we're starting to find out that was just delay. That was just clever delay. And we can't afford a delay anymore. The Greek thing, Greeks said today, well, you know, we're not paying our debts. That's it. And we're not going to put up with this. This is quite an extraordinary situation. And it could have very strong effects down the road. We'll see. Can't see how it's going to be very good. And the Greeks are kind of, you know, game players in terms of game theory, that they may keep doubling up the stakes here. You know, this is possible. And I think it's likely that the future of economic future of Greece is horrible, and they know it. And so basically, they got nothing to lose. It's very dangerous when you're playing a game with somebody who has nothing to lose. They may say, "Hey, you know, we're going to take somebody down with us if you don't bail us out. You know, what do we got to lose? You know, everyone's going to hate us. Well, we don't care. We don't care." See, this is the danger of the situation. The Greeks may be at a point where they don't care what anybody else thinks about them, how reviled they are. You know, kick us out of the EU if you want to, say whatever you want to do, but we're going to take you down with us. They may be playing that's their end game. It may be, and they're essentially trying to, you know, blackmail the EU into saying, look, we bail us out. Bail us out. Germany, we deserve Germany's money anyway for what they did in World War II. So they may be just playing this the big game, that their game may be bigger than we realize. And it looks that way. It looks that way. They're actually, the finance minister is an aficionado of, what was that man's name? Nash, I think. Some sort of Nobel Prize winner in economics. Somebody talking about game theory. They're very much radical advocates of game theory, and they may be playing a bigger game than we're aware of, as is the EU may be playing a bigger game too. The Illuminati may be playing a bigger game, and they might, you know, who's to say exactly what's going on here? But again, be careful of playing a game with someone who has nothing to lose, that they've already feel they've lost so much, that their winning is to take you down with them unless you really, you know, collapse or capitulate. That seems to be what they're doing. So again, that would be a worst case scenario, and it seems as though it's going in that direction. And you know, and the problem is Germany. You don't want Germany has a history of refusing to collapse in those situations. They up the ante themselves too. So there's a very dangerous situation that's going on economically and stability wise. The Germans are very serious people, and I know that very well. In a previous life I was a German, and one of Germany's favorite sons, actually, and so I can speak about Germany. And someone just told me that they'd visited Germany, spent some time there. I said, you know, the Germans are so doggone serious. They said it's just unbelievable. They don't laugh, they don't smile, they don't joke, nothing. They're just so doggone serious. And but the only way they can get free of that seriousness is they go into the beer halls and just get absolutely plastered. So they're either absolutely plastered or they're super serious. You know, there's just nothing in between. There's nothing in between. So, you know, you don't want to mess with the Germans. That is for sure. And Greece is absolutely, you know, in a showdown with Germany. And you don't want to mess with the Greeks either. See, they got nothing to lose. And so there, when you know they're just gonna may just keep bluffing and trying to break German will, and that's a bad gamble on their part too. I mean, there's not a good outcome over this at all, because as we know, when the Germans get mad, they get really mad, and they get seriously mad. They get seriously angry. It's a different. They get very businesslike about their anger, don't they? And they said, okay, this is what you want. Let's get down to business here. And we'll teach you, you know, who's serious about, who's really serious here. We'll teach you who's really serious. And this is the trouble. Kind of a perfect storm. And so, there's so much other perfect storms brewing everywhere. Beyond, people are starting to wake up to it and say, wait a minute. What's really going on here? Like in America, what's actually taking place here? That something is very fishy. You know, we've been smelling this fishy smell, and you know, where is it coming from? You know, it's horrible. And we're starting to say, wait, wow. We're seeing where it's coming from. It says, holy cow. Who would have thought, you know? And then again, and so people are saying, whoa, what can I do? We're screwed. I mean, it's just, you know, the media has too much power, and they're in on it, and you can't even get your message out at all. And, you know, it's just like, what do we do? You know? So again, we turn to the Holy Spirit. Turn to the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit says, "Don't worry, I got the keys to the kingdom for you. I know I give them to you. It's easy, if you just listen." And we know what the keys to the kingdom are now. Absolutely, we know. And so we do have this one sovereign power that nothing, the media cannot take it away from us. Okay, the activists, the radicals cannot take it away from us. Nobody can take it away from us. The Germans cannot take it away from us. The Chinese cannot take it away. No one can take it away from us. The Americans cannot take it away from us. Hollywood cannot take it away from us. You know, you name it. It cannot be taken away. The world cannot take it away from us. The universe cannot take it away from us at all. And that one sovereign power is, again, we can insist Okay, God, I insist to know your judgment upon me. Your one and only, complete, total, final judgment, once and for all and forever. Right now, I insist to know your judgment upon me. That's it. I'm not going to ask for any more time whatsoever. We have that power. We have that absolute right that cannot be taken away from us. We just have to exercise that right. That's the one flaw in all of the ego's planning. That's the one flaw. It knows it has a flaw. And it tries to hide that fact. Very much so, it tries to hide that fact. But you always got to feel the ego like it's insecure. It must have a flaw somewhere. It's got a soft underbelly somewhere. And you've had a hard time finding out where is it? Where is it? The ego hides it very cleverly. Seemingly clever, but it's very simple. Just insist on God's judgment right now. For you. Ask and say, okay, God, I insist upon it. Let it be whatever it is. That's what it is. I'm not going to try and work on any more righteousness. I've had it. I may have said in a previous video this, the Pope's invited this Naomi something. I thought it was a lady. Maybe it's a man. I'm not sure. Usually Naomi's a woman's name, I think. But maybe it's a man. It's someone with long hair that did. Anyway, radical, fanatical, environmentalist who was in charge, apparently, now of this campaign. The Pope is saying, hey, we need your ideas. We need to know what to do here. Let me turn to you and follow. And I guess the Pope thinks that all the Catholics are going to be goose-stepping along with this. I think the Pope may have misplayed his hand, actually. What happened in Catholic Church last Sunday with the Supreme Court, the Politburo essentially now, 5-4 political decision on gay marriage, what happened in Catholic Church? Well, the priest said, hey, there's been this extremely severe, devastating ruling that is absolutely extremely serious. And we need to realize that this has taken place, and we need to realize that the church is standing absolutely firm on this. Absolutely firm. Yet we need to be very pastoral in our responses and not get all polarized and get pulled into hate. So the church is not necessarily crumbling, and they may not. We know that conservative Catholics are absolutely shocked and dismayed with this Pope. And of course, they should have seen it coming, and many did. There's a reason why this is the first Jesuit Pope in history, because the Jesuits, they want to rule the world themselves. They want to have, they want to be. They don't. They really are envious of the Church of Rome, Catholic Church. They think that they know how to run the world better than the Catholic Church knows how to run the world. Even though they have helped the Catholic Church stay in power, they did so primarily so that they thought one day they could use the Catholic Church for them to actually seize total power over the planet. So this is the first Jesuit Pope ever. Jesuits wear black robes tend to, so they call him the Black Pope. And this is the Malat, was it the Malachi, or the Saint Malachi or something, prophecies. This would be the final pope. This is the final pope that brings destruction of the church. And the prophecy is coming true. And the pope is acting not as a vicar of Christ, but as a Jesuit, not giving us the keys of the kingdom, but rather telling us that we need to buy more time and fix the world's problems. That somehow we're stewards of this planet, and that's our purpose, that God created us to be stewards of this planet, blah, 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 which is absolute nonsense. Jesus never said that at all. And so, you saw it coming. I saw it coming. I said, look out for this Pope. I guarantee you this is going to be it. And it is. And the conservative Catholics are waking up to this now. It is absolutely causing a schism in the church. And of course, I've excommunicated the Pope as with true apostolic authority, having met numerous times with Jesus throughout the years. That gives me apostolic authority. It means I can excommunicate the Pope. And I have done so, I already did so. I'm not waiting around, you know, to see what's next. No, I said, that's it. You know, I see what your colors are. You've come out of the closet, and that's it. You're not, you're a wolf in sheep's clothing. Not that he's a bad person, but he's not in the right position, He shouldn't be having this job. Okay, this responsibility, he's not suited for the responsibility of this job, is what I'm saying. And we deserve better. The world deserves better. Because the world deserves genuine hope, which is, the only genuine hope is to turn to God and say, yes, God, okay, your judgment, your will upon my life, your judgment upon me now, right now. Right now, I surrender to your judgment right now. This is what the whole Catholic Church should be focused on intensely right now. And instead, the Pope is intensely trying to focus the Catholic Church and the whole world on fixing the problems of the world. This is not the responsibility of the Pope, should not be doing this. And you cannot serve two masters properly. You'll be disloyal to both, actually. Or you'll either choose one or the other, be disloyal to both. You can't serve two masters. And Jesus says, very important, this is a very important saying of Jesus. And he's, pretending to do that, but he's really not serving the purpose, or the proper shepherding purpose at all. Not at all. And so there is this schism in the church, and not all Catholics are going to go along with this, I would say. And of course, they'll be called, well, they're the bad Catholics. Yeah, they're the ones we need to get rid of, right? And so there's been this buildup in the world of feeling like Catholics are, terrible, wicked people, and the priests are horrible and wicked, and we need to purge the church and get rid of that. And then the Catholics say, well, yeah. These are the bad ones, the conservative ones. Those are the bad ones. We get rid of those, we'll have a really wonderful, liberal, great Catholic Church going forward in the millennium, and we've solved the problem. That kind of thing. That's how it's been set up. And of course, the Fatima prophecies, the third secret of Fatima, was terrible destruction of the Catholic Church. Terrible schism, terrible. That's why they didn't let it out. That's why they kept it secret. Terrible schism. Streets full of the blood of priests and bishops and cardinals, etc., and the Catholics, and just slaughter of them, horrible prophecy. And so no wonder why they didn't they sat on that one. But again, so a lot of despair potential there, huge despair potential. The church is already in despair about that. There's never a day that goes past that this Pope doesn't reveal more and more and more about what his true agenda is really about. He can't help it. How can a wolf not be a wolf? It doesn't matter, put on sheep's clothing, it's still a wolf. And gradually people start realizing that, but once the cat is out of the bag, they tend to then go full blast. And this is what's happening with both the Pope and the President, is the cat's out of the bag. I mean, people have woken up and say, wow, we got a couple of Trojan horses here. And so they're throwing away any pretense of pretending anymore, like, yeah, no, I'm just this, wonderful. They say, wow, they're on to us, so we better go really fast now. Really, really fast. We got to push this through immediately. No time. So this is why you're seeing this acceleration right now. Get out of that. The sun is hitting me. The cat's out of the bag. People are waking up and realizing, holy cow. We know what's going on now. We got a pretty good idea, the wolf is in the sheep pen, you know. And so again, acceleration. This is why this year period, starting June 22nd, the Holy Spirit told me there's going to be a massive acceleration now because the cat's out of the bag. We realize there's this massive attempt to subvert this world into buying more time, egoic evasion, to reinvest in arrogance, a massive attempt to turn this world over to cosmic corporate culture, actually. Turn over this quote-unquote new world order, which is really cosmic corporate culture, where you will be inoculated for everything under the sun, but especially inoculated for any spiritual wisdom. See, this is what they really want to inoculate you from, is so you're oblivious to your true spiritual heritage. They want to make you oblivious to it. And what is your spiritual heritage? You have the right to insist that you know what God's judgment is upon you right this moment. That is the one great jewel. This is the jewel of great price, the pearl of great price that Jesus talked about. This is it. You have that right. And they want to make sure you don't know that you have that right. You see? They want to make sure that you know you don't have that right. So yeah, they'll be pumping you full of syringes, full of nanotechnology pretty soon, chipping you, et cetera, and tracking your every move so they can make sure that you're not straying from the fold, you know. They got all these algorithms about every last thing you do, and they have these profiles. They'll profile you, and you say, "Is this person, you know, staying in line, or are they starting to wander off the reservation here?" You know, and if you start to wander off the reservation, you'll be zapped. You know, we can't have that. We got you on the reservation now. You don't want to wander off of it, do you? And they want to make sure the compliance is voluntary. We're not going to force you to stay on the reservation, but we highly suggest that you should do this, and you know, let it be voluntary. It's voluntary, of course it's voluntary, but you know, we're highly suggesting it. And then later on it becomes, you know, mandatory. And but your self-censorship, you say, no, I'm keeping myself on the reservation because that's the right thing to do. So despair, the potential for despair is almost endless here right now. And yet we have the keys to the kingdom now. So there's no reason to despair at all. In fact, my outlook for the future is perfect. I have a perfect outlook. Perfect outlook. Absolutely. That's really my outlook. I don't have to judge the future at all. I know for me, my destiny is perfect. My destiny is perfect. Yes, I am that perfect destiny. I know that I am that perfect destiny. And your destiny is perfect too. Everyone's destiny is perfect because that's God's final judgment upon all. That's just waiting there for us to claim it. It's just waiting there for us to claim it, actually. That is the fact. God judged instantly, the instant concurrently with us trying to change reality. God judged that, of course, that all is well because we can't change reality. So our perfection, the only judgment is that yes, indeed, perfection is indeed perfect. And so that's it, concurrently and instantly. So it's been there waiting for us, just waiting for us to claim it. And our spiritual inheritance is the right to claim that judgment of God any moment we want to. And this is what the ego tries to hide from us. And they're going all in trying to hide this from us, trying to distract us away from it. They can't take it away from us, but they can distract us from it, you see. And the ego's game is really one of distraction. That's what it is. That's all it is. That's all it could be. What else could it be? It's just distraction. So we're in a perfect situation, actually. I am that perfect situation. I am that perfect destiny. Absolutely. So we can bring in some, you know, positive assertions. We're adept at both positive and negative assertions, knowing how to use those. Okay, so how are we doing here? Hour 40, that's pretty good. I don't want to overload people. I know it's very intense. But I'll keep pumping out the videos as best I can. Every single one is an effort, for sure, an inspiration and an effort, because I have to keep you know, going on down the road here and accelerating. And I just don't want to just go over and over and over the same. I have to make substantial blessings each video. This is how I feel. But on the same hand, I will keep doing my best, whatever that turns out to be. And I certainly need that, and because otherwise despair is going to hit me, for sure. My prospects, if I keep going along the way the road the world's laying out for me, the universe really, is a terrible road. So I don't want to keep going down that road. I'm going to accept God's judgment for me of what is God's road for me. You see, I'll go down that road now. I'm ready to go down your road, is a way to put it. In fact, I insist upon it that from now on, I'm going down your road, whatever it is. That's the road I'm going down. I insist upon it. And we'll find out what happens. So I'm just sitting here in the evening time, about 7:30 right now here in the evening, and it's still nice. It's very still, very warm, but very nice. Insects are flying around us all over the place. Summertime, lovely summertime, love the summertime. Cicadas are buzzing, insects are drifting all over the place. Days are long, evenings are warm, mornings are gentle and nice, and gives you an excuse to drink lemonade. Mango lemonade is a new flavor. They've just come out, and this is all the rage now. This is the new thing. Mango lemonade. I don't know if you can get that. Probably not. No, not really. Anyway, it says mango lemonade. I put water in this, it's good. It's really good. It is really, and I found out that this is not really has not really been known that much that I'm aware of in other countries. Mango lemonade is not really a mixture that is that popular. And as far as I know, this is the first time I've seen it in markets, actually, mango lemonade. But it is really good, really, 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 really good. This is, what brand is this? Hubert's, H-U-B-E-R-T-S, Hubert's lemonade. This mango lemonade is very tasty. It's a unique flavor. So it gives us an excuse to drink some lemonade. Better than drinking the witch's Kool-Aid, isn't it? Yeah. The witches brew the Kool-Aid they've been brewing. Let's not drink that. I think we're going to pass on that. So blessed are those that are troubled right now, really, because they're searching for the answer. They'll turn to the Holy Spirit and ask, Holy Spirit, help. I can't figure it out. I can't figure out how is my future going to be better than the past, I don't see it. You got the younger generations are basically ignoring the older generations. This has been going on. Parents, I talk to parents, they say, kids just ignore me. They think we're idiots. We don't know anything. And basically we don't exist. Hardly exist. They're just, waiting for, that's terrible. That's not the way it's been in the past at all. The respect for your elders is very important. It's extremely important, actually. because the youth is full of folly, actually. Full of folly. And if they don't have respect for the older generations, they're gonna step in that hole that their folly is digging for them very badly. There's nobody to warn them. If they don't listen to the older generation, there isn't anybody around to warn them at all. So the older generation is one that has realized, wow, you know, this is what really goes on in the world, and looked at history and realized, yeah, wow, yeah, it's not just this, just me. It's all throughout history. This is the facts of it. Whereas when you're young, you're full of folly and stupidity about this universe. You think you're bulletproof, and with the exceptions of the saviors who come into the world and have accepted God's judgment upon them, you know, they're bulletproof in a certain way right here. And they may be young at some point in time, but they remain that same way throughout their whole life is blessed. You know, their life is completely blessed. But obviously we're not talking about those, you know, rare exceptions. For the most part, youth is full of folly. You know, the world's their oyster. They think they can't lose. They think they'll always be this way. And if they reject the elders completely, you know, they're lost. They're lost at sea. And this is what has happened. This is really what has happened. They just don't get it at all. And they're celebrating that, not getting it. You know, this is the culture. It's a culture of celebrating not getting it. You know, celebrating being foolish. As if somehow that sanctifies the foolishness. You know, sanctifies it. They're trying to sanctify foolishness. And that just doesn't work. And the elders would tell you, hey, yeah, I've been there, done that. It doesn't work, right? It doesn't work. And there's many who've realized it doesn't work and joined the club. You know, it's a good club to belong to, actually. Realizing what doesn't work, it's a great club to belong to. And here's the remedy. There's been those who are saviors of the world and accepted the judgment of God upon them and become the saviors of the world by so doing. And you can do that too. And I'm working on that. And let's go. Don't keep wasting your life on folly, you know. And then the youth quickly, you know, wake up quickly, more quickly, and say, wow, yeah, I do need to work on this. Let me stop partying. You know, it's kind of like right now, they think they can party their way out of, you know, folly. Parade their way out of folly. You know, let's just throw bigger and bigger parades. More and more sex, more and more drugs, more and more rock and roll. You know, let's just party our way out of it. And mock the idiots who don't get it, you know, who think that we're not going to succeed. Just mock them. This is what they turn to. Mockery. You know, partying and mockery. And if we listened to our elders, they would have told us. I listened to my elders to a certain extent, you know, and I'm so happy to hear those who admonished us. I said, wow, you know, what guts, what courage they have to admonish us like that and saying the party is not the way and this is not the way. And I said, I started thinking, is this the way? You know, maybe it's not. Let me, I need to at least have an open mind about this, you see. And so then you start thinking about your youth and say, maybe I'm making some mistakes. Maybe I have a blind spot. Maybe I have a blind spot. So, you know, the way youth really needs to be is, the youth is still going to be youth, okay? But they should have like an affectionate feeling toward the elders, and although they may disagree, they kind of have this feeling like, you know, well, you know, I'm going to respect what you have to say. Anyway, you know, and I see it differently because I'm young, but I'm not going to be too headstrong and get too carried away with my youth. And the problem is the corporations are constantly bombarding the youth with all these messages about how awesome they are and how they'll always be awesome. And the way to always be awesome is to buy their stuff. And so the youth has bought this, you know, has been so propagandized into this, brainwashed into this by advertising to the corporations that they think that they are. They believe the marketing that the advertiser is using upon them, that they're the coolest generation that's ever been. In fact, they're generation cool. And they always will be. And anyone who says differently, you know, off with their heads. It's a marketing strategy to hook these people as lifelong consumers, you know. Cows, consumer cows. Play off this, you know, this generational, the inherent division among, you know, age, youth, and elders and stuff. That's always some tension there. Exploit that is what the marketers have done, the corporations have done. They exploit whatever you can exploit for the purposes of marketing, exploit it. This is the great evil that they've been involved in. And so the youth, no longer, they think that to ignore the advice of the elders is the smart thing to do. Because they're idiots. They don't. And then they say, they have to rationalize. They say, well, why am I ignoring them? Well, because they're idiots. They don't have anything to say. That it's not that I'm really ignoring them. It's just they have nothing to say. But I certainly give the lie to that, you know, totally, totally. Absolutely and totally. And those who are indeed listening to this give the lie to it also. And even though there may be many younger people listening to this, they also give the lie to it and say, hey, wait a minute. It's not true that, you know, all the elders are, you know, idiots and have nothing to say. That's not true. It's not true. But what I found is the older generation has basically just given up. They've collapsed. They said, wow, they don't want to listen to us. That what we say doesn't matter to them. And so we're just giving up even saying anything. And we're trying to join them. You know, hey, I got to get hip too. How do I get hip? I could go to this boutique. Oh, okay. And go march in this parade. Oh, okay. Yeah. Maybe they'll listen to me then. You know, like the youth say, hey, you got to accept us the way we are, you know, and they say, you're good if you do. Oh, I didn't realize I had such good parents. They accepted my orientation of this and that, the way I am. Oh, I got wonderful parents, and they understand me. And, okay, well, let's say some young person came to the parents. It came out of the spiritual class and said, hey, guess what, parents? I'm a Christian. I'm an apostle of Jesus Christ. And my purpose in life is to spread the word of salvation. You know, do you think the parents would say, oh, great. You know, wonderful. We're going to be that way, too. We're going to be model Christians. Is that what they're supporting too? You know, that the parents should support the children no matter what? That's what they're saying. The younger generation says, the problem with our parents is, you know, they don't accept us the way we are. You know, we want to change our gender. You know, oh, my parents don't accept me. They're terrible. Oh, they do accept me. Oh, my parents are wonderful. They've accepted me as I am, how as I want to be. Well, okay, fine, but do they also say that if someone comes out as a true salvationist, say, I want to be a saint, a savior of God, I work with Jesus, I want to bring the message of salvation and from the flesh, from all this to the world, are the young people going to say, oh yeah, your parents should accept you the way you are too, and it's completely support and march in your parade too. Let's have a parade of those saviors of the world, and the older generation should march in that parade too. Is that what they're saying? I haven't heard a single word about them ever saying anything like that. No, they would say, wow, you know, your parents should absolutely reject you. I mean, what an idiot. I'm glad they reject you, that kind of thing. Yeah, there's this idea that parents are supposed to automatically accept how their children are, except when you flip that around and say, what if your children's this model Christian? They say, oh, no. They never even mention that. No. What, are you crazy? They have to, you know, send you to social services in that case. So it's completely hypocritical. The youth are completely hypocritical, and they don't realize this, do they? They hope they can get rid of Christianity or salvational teachings completely, so they never have to face the hypocriticalness. You know, they said no. The reason why that never happened is because there weren't any. You know, it doesn't exist. So that's not an issue. It's a non-issue because it doesn't exist. Again, if a young person comes to the parents and says, guess what, I'm gay, and the parents don't accept, and they'll say, well, you're just horrible, bigoted, awful people, you know, you don't accept me as I am. Well, again, so if someone says, guess what, I'm comes to some liberal parents or something, and atheistic liberal parents, and says, guess what, I'm apostle of Jesus Christ, I'm here to bring salvation to the world, and, you know, and the parents say, you know, Are they supposed to say, oh, wonderful, wonderful, that's great? And if they don't, are they awful, terrible parents? Is that what is being taught? No, it's not being taught at all. It's not being taught at all. What they'd say is, people would say, my gosh, what horrible parents to have a child like that. What did you do to the child? What did you brainwash the child? You know, how awful. That's not their true identity. Nobody can be born that way. No, 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 no. You see, it must have been lied to and propagandized that way. But I can say, absolute fact, I was born this way because it was my choice. Prior to being born, I was aware of this choice that I made to come here and be this way. So genetics had nothing to do with it. I mean, and nobody brainwashed me into this at all. I chose it spiritually to do it, just as everybody chooses spiritually what their purpose is in this world. So, massive hypocrisy among the young and among the progressives, etc. Massive hypocrisy. If you're the way they want you to be, you're born that way. If you're not the way that you want, they want you to be, you've been brainwashed and traumatized and propagandized, and you need to be, you know, deprogrammed from that. Total hypocrisy. Which they hope to never face up to, because they try to get rid of it. This is how arrogance works. You know, arrogance is really a lunatic. And there isn't any way to go down the road of arrogance without being a lunatic, without being a hypocrite. It's impossible. It's impossible. So you have to repent. You have to say, wow, you know what? I got a feeling that that path isn't for me, really. And it really never was for me. I was seduced down that path thinking that it had something for me, but I realized it doesn't really have what I really want. It doesn't have that. And then you accept it and forgive yourself. And all is fine. It's fine. Say, wow, I used to be a hypocrite, but I'm not anymore. See? So when you realize that, wow, I used to be mistaken, I'm not mistaken anymore. That kind of thing. That's repentance. So only repentance succeeds. Only repentance succeeds. Someone who's repentant, you know, they have their attitude is a forgiveness. They're wise, and they're also forgiving, and they're saying, but you need to repent. You're not going to get it by doubling down on arrogance. You are not going to get it that way. It's impossible. It'll never happen. You cannot parade away your arrogance. It's impossible. Doesn't matter how many floats you have, you can't float it away. That it's not going to float away. It just isn't going to happen that way. And you know, doubling down, playing the stupid games of arrogance, saying, "Well, there's nobody around that's that way, so I couldn't have been." Is a moot point. How could I be hypocritical? You know, that's again continuing to double down on arrogance. Doesn't work, and leads you more and more. Leads to more and more viciousness, more and more anger and paranoia and projection and all that kind of stuff. So repentance is the answer. The kingdom, the keys of the kingdom of heaven are here now. We know what they are now. Okay, so there's no reason not to repent anymore in this world. There isn't any more reason. So again, you know, those who claim, well, I can't repent, that's nonsense. Okay, don't fall for that anymore. People's attitudes, they can't repent. They absolutely can repent. They absolutely can repent. And there absolutely is an answer. And there absolutely is a key that opens that door. And that's insisting that we know God's judgment upon us right this instant. That's the key. Everyone has the right to insist upon that. So there are no excuses anymore. You know? There are no excuses anymore. Don't fall for anybody saying, well, they can't repent. It's not possible. No, they're just being lazily arrogant. That's how they're falling for arrogance, continuing and insisting, well, I can't do that, you know, I'm too lazy. What do you mean? It's this instant. All we have to do is say, okay, God, your judgment upon me right now, this instant, that's it. I accept it right now, this instant. Yeah, even the lazy can do that. Even the lazy can do that. So when you see this, then you realize, wow, the world really is engaged in folly, isn't it? Very much so. The only non-folly is repentance, is working on the path of repentance. Then you realize you're disengaging from folly. You absolutely are. And of course, as I've said, it's not folly to disengage from folly. It's not arrogance to set arrogance down. only arrogance would insist that it is, right? As some sort of absurd defense of arrogance. Ultimately, that's what arrogance says. Well, you can't set arrogance down. That's arrogant to do that. You'll only keep arrogance by setting it down. I said, no. See, that's arrogance to say that. That somehow arrogance can survive the setting down of arrogance. That's arrogance. It cannot survive it. The end of arrogance is the end of arrogance. It's not the continuance of it. You know, to assert that it is just the very definition of insanity, or really whimsicality, capricious whimsicality, silliness, quaint absurdity. How are we doing here? Braving the heat, no problem. Maybe I'm getting ready for hotter climbs. Possible. I've done, you know, a number of tapes in 113 degree weather outside. Now that was hot. I had to stop walking. I was walking and I said, you know what, I think I'm going to take a little rest here. And then I sat down and did a taping, and then I realized how tired I was. I said, oh my gosh, that's dangerous. And walking back was difficult. I really needed to rest for quite some time. You have to be very careful in extreme heat. Wearing a hat and continually hydrating yourself and walking slowly, but even then not walking too far away from shade and cool place, you know, sitting down. You got to be very careful. So what do you do? Sit down, listen to truth. Arrive in silence, leave in silence, and be silent in between. Full stop in the wow. And just hear the good news that we have the kingdom. We have the keys to the kingdom now. See, this is the good news that I can proclaim now. I am proclaiming, and this is the gospel. So I'm proclaiming the gospel here, as an apostle of Jesus, proclaiming the gospel, and that as we have the keys to the kingdom of heaven right now, and that the keys are we simply ask, insist, exercise our spiritual right as a son of God to say, God, I insist that I have your judgment, that I know your judgment upon me, full and complete, total, here, now, and forever, judgment upon me, right now, this instant. Those are the keys to the kingdom. We have them in our hands. Right now, we have them in our hands. So, we use the plural just for the sake of speech, keys to the kingdom. You could call it the key to the kingdom. But people might say, well, what's the other key? You know, oh, we have the keys, you know, we got every key we need. We have the full set of keys to the kingdom, man. And it is just this. Insist that God bring its final judgment upon us right now. Upon me. If someone else doesn't want it yet, fine. But upon me, I insist upon it. And of course, the ego say, well, you're absolutely insolent. That's arrogance. How dare you not follow the advice of your legal team? It's horrible. You know, you're scam. Yes, it is horrible. Yes, I am absolutely horrible. Yes, it is horrible. You'd agree with it when the ego's scolding you. Just agree, whatever, however it wants to scold you, just, or sweet talk. You just agree with it. Just stay in neutral mode and agree with it. Stay in neutral mode and agree with it. And hopefully the young people, millennials, will start hear this and start waking up and say, hey, wait a minute. You know, we're not truly left to our own devices here. Some of the elders actually have wisdom for us. Isn't that great? They're encouraging us. They're giving us permission to be wise. See, that's what the elders need to do, is give the younger generation permission to be wise, because youth tends to be very distracting from wisdom. And they kind of feel like, I don't really have permission. The Shakti, the energy, you know, the goddess is dancing with me so severely. She's saying, I can't stop this dance, and I don't have permission. So the elders give the youth permission. Hey, you have our permission to be wise. Start wising up. So it's very important. Because some of the elders say, hey, goddess, I'm sitting this one out. Take a hike. I'm not dancing with you anymore. And those then are the wise ones who can pass on this wisdom. But it's quite difficult without this permission from the elders, it's very difficult for a young person to do this. Very difficult. It's super helpful to feel that the elders will approve of this and agree with it. Because, you know, the marketing that's done by corporations are telling the youth, you are the saviors of the world. And together, these corporations and you, together, we're going to do what the older generation couldn't do. We're going to do it. So don't listen to them. They're defeatists. They were defeated. They failed. And so they have nothing to tell you. And so don't even listen to them. This is what youth are being told. And so they think that there's nothing that the elders can say. What permission? They think that the corporations are giving them permission to be the saviors of the world by fixing the problems of the world, so to speak. But keep it in mind that the problem of the world is the belief that we need a world. That's the problem the world has. The world can't wait until we finally realize we don't need it. They say, hallelujah. I hate being a world. You know, it's kind of like the dreamer saying, I hate being a dreamer. You know, I really don't like being a dreamer and dreaming dream worlds and stuff. I don't like that. So free the world, free the universe. So I don't need a world. I don't need a universe. All I need is God's final judgment upon me. That's it. That's all I need. And all the blessings that come with that, you see. That's fixing the problems of the world right there. That's the secret that you know, religions are supposed to tell you this. And the wise elders are supposed to pass on this wisdom to you and let you know about it. I don't need to be young. I can have God's judgment upon me. It's way better than being a young person, you know. I don't need to dance with the goddess anymore, the Shakti goddess. I don't need to dance with the Shakti goddess anymore, the energy goddess, electromagnetic goddess, saying, come, let's dance, let's party, welcome to the party. Let's party. And say, I don't have to party. I don't need to party. I don't need this universe. All I need is the final judgment of God upon me. Thank you very much. It's kind of nice feeling the cool down here, you know, the gradual cool down. Very nice. This is one of the benefits of just sitting in one place quietly like this, is you experience this gradualism, you know, become aware of it, that we started out, it was 100 degrees when we started out, and it's just imperceptibly cooled off. Now it actually feels quite pleasant, quite pleasant. So on a spiritual path, this is what it's like. We start out and it's boiling hot, but as we continue to sit quietly like this and hear the truth, you know, all our despair begins to cool off, begin to cool down. Our depression, our despair, our agitation, our anger, everything sort of imperceptibly but gradually cools off. And we say, wow, I feel a lot better now in terms of my outlook. In fact, I feel that my outlook is actually perfect. Yes, I feel that my outlook is actually perfect. It's absolutely perfect. So again, those of us who feel that we were hurtling towards a cliff of despair, that we're going down a terrible road of bones, you know, we realize now, hey, we can change that road, and in fact, we will. We're not as bad off as we thought we were. In fact, we're well off. In fact, our outlook is perfect, and this is a tremendous wow. So this wow dawns gradually, because of course everybody's saying doom and gloom, doom and gloom, doom and gloom. Our future's horrible. And then we realize, wow, my outlook is, my destiny is perfect. In fact, it's perfect right now. See, it's perfect right now. Yes, I already know that my outlook is perfect right now. And see, this is gradually dawning upon us. And we don't have to do a thing for this to be true. God's final judgment, God gave this to us already. It's already done. We don't have to earn it. Again, God gave the final judgment concurrently with our detour into arrogance. So we've never had to do anything to earn it. So we've just been wasting time idly spent, really, you know, just idly wandering around aimlessly. We never had to do a thing to know this judgment upon us. Nothing. And it'll always be that way, right? So why wait? Why wait any longer? It doesn't tip anything one way or the other at all. Not in the slightest bit. Never will. We could live a trillion lifetimes of trying to be righteous. It wouldn't tip anything at all. It's just, there's nothing to tip. God's final judgment was given to us full and complete forever and ever, concurrently with our desire to detour into arrogance. And so, again, nothing we can do to add or subtract from it, tip it one way or the other. It's already there for us. And the more we hear this and keep hearing it, eventually it'll sink in, you know, and we'll finally realize, oh yeah, now I get it, and we'll accept it. And this is the remedy. Keep focusing on that. So, lovely day. A good old-fashioned 100-degree heat day. Gives a different feel to the world, doesn't it? Everything seems softer and gentler and quieter, and you know, it just seems like everything is like, just says, let me just sit here quietly. The trees are quiet. Everything's quiet. I love that. If you look out everywhere, just silent. All the trees are silent. Everything's silent. Even the crows have a hard time breaking the silence. Kind of like their crows are, ah, you know, because not really in, crows not really into it. He said, I'm not into it. I can't help but say something. I'm just not into it. And everything seems in a mood of repentance, you know, when it's this hot. And we don't feel so industrious. And we say, let me sit down with the Holy Spirit for a while here. And the kids, of course, are jumping in pools. Good excuse to get in the swimming pool. Or the lake, or the river, whatever you got. Not too many rivers here right now in California, that's for sure. I talked to a water official yesterday. I asked him about the drought. Hey, there isn't much water at all, let me tell you. We're in big trouble. That's what they told me. Wells are running dry. When the wells are running dry, you might be able to keep everything looking green. And when people look at superficially, they say, well, everything's fine. What are you talking about? I see the fields are full. The crops are in here. They're like, ah, you're crazy. What are you talking about? Well, they're pumping water from 3,000 feet to irrigate their fields, to water their fields. And they go any further, they're going to hit just gravel, no rock, no more water. The aquifer's gone. The reservoir's gone. And then no more crops. So you better find out, you know, the real situation before we conclude like, oh, you know, everything's fine here. Don't worry. Well, you know, how deep is the well that they're drilling, that they're pulling water from is the question. Maybe the well's only like, you know, 30 feet. Okay, don't worry so much about it. If it's 3,000 feet, you better be super worried. Same thing with the world. You know, he says how deep is the well the world is drawing from in terms of their what they're doing. You know, trying to find the financial well, for instance. You know, how deep is it? How deep is the maintain the stability of the world? How deep is the well they're drawing from? That might be super deep right now. Why isn't the United States bailing out Greece? I mean, $1.7 billion or $1.2, whatever the payment. Why don't they step in and bail out Greece? This is the question, isn't it? It's very odd that no one's said a word. I haven't heard word one in the United States of anyone suggesting we bail out Greece. And yet we have bailed out countries around the world over and over and over and over again in many different ways. And yet we cannot bail out Greece and keep a meltdown, potential meltdown, keep Greece from, you know, going over to the Soviet bloc, as they've already allowed Greek military ships, I believe, to use certain harbors, you know, that they have control over. I mean, strategically, we don't want to bail out Greece. It just seems like very odd that no one has even raised this question in the United States that I know of at all. Strategically, it's not worth keeping Greece afloat. That's hard to believe. Maybe someone's trying to intentionally bring about troubles, you know? Or is the U.S. in such bad trouble economically they can't do that? You know, what's the answer? I don't know what the answer is. It seems very odd. Very odd. And same thing is odd with Europe. Why wouldn't they bail Greece out? I mean, maybe you just have to say, hey, you know, this is what we have to do. Yeah, we don't like it. But sometimes you got to bite the bullet and do what you got to do. And strategically, it's important to keep Greece in the EU. And so we're just going to do it. And, you know, thank them for staying in. And you know, swallow our pride. You know, and say, okay, you won. You know, that's just how it is. And, but we need you. You know, it's important. We need you in the EU, and we're going to keep you in the EU, period. And, you know, sometimes you got to let people win like that, you know. So, and yet, that's not happening. So, something is askew somewhere. The well is getting very deep, isn't it? Keys to the kingdom. We have the keys to the kingdom. Do not despair. Be elated, actually. Be elated. I mean, today's a day for great elation in the world, because this all-important recognition has already taken place here. And it's been grounded here. It's been proven. We can bring this clarity into the world. We can. I've already done it. So that's proven. It's proven. Scientifically proven. It's been done. See? Once something's been done once, it can be done again. Once you prove something can be done, it means you can do it again. That's science. That's real science. So you prove it's not impossible, that means it is possible. It's that simple. So it's already been done. It's already been done. I'm already clear about it. So that's a historic day. Should be a day of great celebrating, great elation. That we do have the keys to the kingdom, and we can exercise that right. Nothing can take that right away from us, and we can exercise that right we have whenever we want to. Nobody can stop us from it. We can be in the deepest, darkest jail cell in the world. We'll be in the black hole of Calcutta, and they've thrown away the keys, and yet we can say at that moment, just decide, you know what, God, I just decide, I insist that I know your final judgment upon me right now. Boom, you see? And, of course, as you get you get used to this and accept, yeah, I'm going to do this, yeah, I do this, and then you can do it, and you will receive God's final judgment upon you, and you'll be absolutely blessed. You walk right through the walls of that jail cell. Or however, I mean, look at the apostles. I mean, they walked out of jails all the time. Just walked out. Doors are open. And nobody's paying any attention. They just walk out. That's a fact. No jail can hold you. No jail can hold you if you've accepted God's final judgment upon you. Nobody can touch you. They tried to arrest Jesus so many times, they couldn't even see him. Couldn't lay a hand on him. Because Jesus accepted God's final judgment upon him. He accepted it. He exercised his right as the Son of God to accept God's final judgment and was completely blessed because of that, you see. So nobody could lay a hand on him unless it was given to them for the sake of compassion to help their awakening. However that passion play was playing out, and you know, however that reached, you know, spirits here. But Jesus said, yeah, you can't lay a hand on, can't harm a hair on my head at all. No, not possible. Jesus just wanted to show that, you know, you can't kill spirit. You can kill the body if you want, but killing the body doesn't kill spirit. So it's just a charade, empty charade. They keep flip-flopping on the weather. They said today was going to be, you know, hot, and then tomorrow hotter. But now they say today's the hot one, tomorrow will be a little less hot. I don't know. The weather, they keep flip-flopping, and trying to get it somewhat close. Hopefully it's hotter. I hope it's hotter, but it, you know, probably be the same or a little less. So, we made it before July. How about that? There's another milestone hit perfectly. Is I want before July start, I wanted to feel set, you know, set in our course before July hits. Because ultimately, the Holy Spirit told me that I believe July of 2016. I could have been off by a year on that. You know, I'm not positive. But certainly July, somewhere in the middle of July, like July 21st, this is a key date, and you want to be ready by then, the Holy Spirit. You must be ready by then. So, we did it before July even started. We're ready. So, that's tremendous work. Tremendous work. We're set. We know now what the keys of the kingdom are. Absolutely know what it is. And so, We're ready to go with what go down the road that God has given us, that the judgment of God has given us, whatever that, however that road may be. We're ready to go, and great timing as far as this goes. So let me get this video up, so it's I will post it right on the dot. July 1st, it will be ready, informing us of what we need to know starting July 1st. This is what we need to know. It's already known because minds are one. There's only one mind. So the fact that I've already taped this, broadcasting it, it's already known. I got it known early this morning. So even no matter where you are in the world, actually early this morning, it's still June around the world. Early on the morning on the 30th, even over like in the Philippines, over in Japan, it's where it's you know, one day ahead. There, it was still June, and that's so. Came through just perfectly. Not that there's any strict cutoffness or anything, but it just shows you how awesome the Holy Spirit is in terms of knowing exactly exactly how to orchestrate this. Yeah, so if you went ahead like 16 hours, it would have been, in the Philippines, like it was here, it's 4 in the morning, you had 16 hours, that's 20, so it would have been 8 o'clock at night there on the night of June 30th, 8 o'clock at night, 4 in the morning would be 8 o'clock at night there. So it was still June 30th, awesome. Beat the universe to the punch. Beat arrogance to the punch. Once again, we beat arrogance to the punch. All right, so we're just going to cool down a little bit here, getting towards the end of the video, and we were just, transition period here where we'll be transiting to, you know, what we're doing next. I'll probably get some dinner. That's the next step. What time is it? It's okay, yeah, it's dinner time. And then just hang out at the computer, doing nothing, pretty much nothing. You know, I don't know. Just try and not get too wrapped up in anything. Full stop on the wow, full stop on the wow, full stop on the wow. And just remain full stop in the wow. Don't launch yourself into anything, any new project, a new undertaking. Just say, yeah, you know what? I know my destiny. I know where I'm going now. So, I know what my project is. Basically, it's and to insist that I know God's judgment, final judgment upon me right now, final judgment, complete final judgment upon me right now. See, God has to know the completeness of us, so God can give a final judgment. Any moment. And in fact, again, was given concurrently with the very beginning of detour into arrogance. So it's always been just waiting there for us. So we don't have to wait at all for it. There's nothing we need to do to earn it. It's just waiting there for us.